Any Sunday morning, you can dial a pastor, dial a church, dial a prayer, dial a religion, dial a gospel, all without getting out of your chair. And Sunday morning, the air is filled with voices, voices that bring in letters by the thousand, contributions by the thousands, and followers by the thousands. And the air is filled with faces, faces at their best because of the expertise of unnumbered technicians who, silent and unseen and unsung, create an atmosphere of success. And you say, what power? But the real power is in the hands of individuals like yourself, who at the slightest whim can wipe it all out in an instant with a single flip of a dial. It is written. This is George Vandeman. Today, It Is Written presents The Electronic Gospel. Who listens on Sunday morning? Shut-ins, those who are ill, those who for one reason or another are unable to attend a church, and those who wouldn't go to church anyway. But it's more than that. There are those who are attracted by the music, those who like the television pastor better than the one down the street, and those who get more out of the sermon when they stay at home, and those who are learning more about the Bible than they ever did before and wouldn't miss the telecast for a world. There are those who are discouraged, so discouraged that they're about to end it all, and suddenly they hear a voice. Something about that voice holds them, and they find hope in Jesus Christ. There are those who are so attracted to a charismatic speaker that they follow him anywhere, even to Guyana. And then there are those who tune in for no apparent reason at all. They're just turning the dial. And there it was. Now they consider the telecast their church. Now dialing our entertainment at random is one thing. But is that the best way to choose a religion? Should changing churches be as simple as a matter as changing channels? Should our moral virtues be decided by a picture tube? Please don't misunderstand me. Thousands trace their first encounter with Christ and with the Bible truth on radio or television. Their whole lives have been changed by what they heard, by what they saw on the screen. I'm not discounting that at all. I'm only asking, should any man's belief, any man's religion, any man's choice of a church be such a random thing, such a trivial thing as changing channels? Should religion be nothing more than entertainment? If you don't like it, just turn the dial. Friend, one of these days soon, the Lord Jesus Christ will return to this earth. And when he does, it'll be real. It'll not be a TV special. But is it possible that millions of people are prepared to handle only unreal, televised, made-up situations? Situations that they can turn off whenever they get uncomfortable? What will they do when they're faced with reality? It's no surprise that this electronic church is controversial. Some see it as a solid-state, transistorized savior of men, a fulfillment of the commission of Christ to take the gospel to all the world. But others see the electronic church as a threat. Secular reporters, not understanding it, may consider it simply a hangover from less sophisticated times. Some church leaders are openly critical, and others, though sympathetic, are justifiably concerned. The question and the fear is simply this: will the habitual Sunday morning viewer ever be motivated to go down the street or across town and find a church of real people? That's the question. And if he does make such a contact, will he be happy there with an ordinary pastor who may not be as good a speaker, with a program not so well oiled or so expensively prepared, with everyday people, some of whom may even be outspoken or hard to love? You see, there's a legitimate concern that television, for millions, might become the church, that no contact will ever be made with a local congregation. There is justifiable concern that vast numbers of men and women may be led to substitute a phantom church for a church of real people. Listen to this. We read over here in the New Testament in the book of Acts concerning the days that followed Pentecost. Acts, the second chapter, and the 27th verse. Listen. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Now, evidently, it's God's plan that there should be a personal involvement with the church. The church is to be a group of people called out from the world and brought together by their common interests and goals. It's to be a very closely knit unit. For the Apostle Paul, speaking of Christ, over here in Ephesians, the first chapter and the 22nd and the 23rd verse, says this, very closely knit, and God placed all things under his feet and appointed him to be head over everything for the church, which is his body. Now, the church is called the body of Christ. Here's a very close relationship. Can you imagine one part of the body never having any contact with other parts of the body? Oh, friend, God bless you for watching It Is Written. I hope you'll continue to do just that. As for me and our group, we will continue to present the gospel in the most appealing way that we can. We'll continue to point you to the Savior of men. But It Is Written cannot be the gospel. It Is Written cannot be your Savior. There's no such thing as salvation by TV. I thank God constantly for television. Television with radio can reach where nothing else can. That's the great strength of the electronic media. But with that great strength comes the problem that concerns many church leaders, and it concerns me. You see, precisely because television does reach everywhere, and because its vast audience is unseen, and unidentified, except as it chooses to be identified, there comes the temptation to remain simply anonymous. Viewers are tempted to become secret disciples of Christ, to choose the telecast that they find most pleasing, make it their church, develop a set of personal beliefs, but never make contact with other believers, with the body of Christ. But God is not looking for secret disciples, for underground Christians. He's looking for those who are willing to make an open commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ that rubs off on people's shoulders every single day. Listen, Nicodemus was a secret disciple. He came to Jesus by night. Now, he was convinced that Jesus was the true Messiah. He used his influence and his voice and his vote in the Sanhedrin to protect Jesus as far as he could. But he never came out openly for him until he saw him die on the cross. Then there was Joseph of Arimathea, another secret disciple of Christ. It was he, you remember, who came forward after the crucifixion and offered the use of his own new tomb for the Savior's burial. Joseph and Nicodemus, with their wealth, were a tremendous strength and blessing to the early church. But how much better it would have been if they'd openly acknowledged their Savior when he needed them. How it would have cheered his heart. And then there's another concern that is voiced by critics of the electronic church. As they see the huge amounts of money coming in through the mails to religious broadcasters, they fear that some television personalities may be using the airwaves and their viewers to enrich themselves. And there may be some justification for that fear. Probably most religious broadcasters are on the air simply because of a compelling conviction that the Word of God must go to all of the world. And yet there's nothing to prevent a man from going into religious broadcasting because he feels that is where the money is. It could happen. However, just a word here. The fact that a few may be using television to enrich themselves, the fact that a few may be insincere, should not hinder viewers from supporting causes that are legitimate. It should create a measure of caution, to be sure. But it should not dry up the source of funds that are so essential for spreading the gospel by millions, 2 millions through television. And by the way, just in case you're wondering, let me say this. Not one dime of it, not a dollar of it is written viewer contributions, ever goes for my personal use or for the personal use of any staff member. My own modest personal salary is paid from other funds entirely. But back to our subject. Another concern of those who look on is the tremendous hold upon the minds and the loyalties of their followers that's exercised by certain television personalities. Television, my friend, is a powerful tool for spreading the gospel. It can also be a powerful tool for the manipulation of minds. Charismatic figure with less than honorable motives could take that tool and use it to draw men and women not to Christ, but to himself, and then to betray them to a Jonestown. Every viewer should ask himself whether he's being attracted by the Lord Jesus Christ, by the man whose voice he hears on radio and television. Is he being attracted to the message or to the messenger? We ought not to be too quick to condemn those who followed Jim Jones. However, people followed Martin Luther in his day, John Wesley in his. If Luther or Wesley had been irresponsible, Lutheranism and Methodism too would have come to tragic ends. People have always followed leaders. People followed the Apostle Paul, and he was concerned about it. Listen. Viewers of It Is Written, I say to you, follow me only as far as I follow the Lord Jesus Christ. Follow this telecast only as far as it follows Scripture. When I stop following Christ, when the message of this telecast departs from Scripture, turn the dial. Recently, I came across a piece of interesting information. It's revealed that the far-out cults have not had much success, much pulling power, in the American Midwest. Observers feel that this lack of interest in these religions is largely because of the fairly conservative, Bible-oriented form that Christianity's assumed there. The cults just don't make any converts where the authority of the Word of God is recognized. And that ought to tell us something. Every week at the close of this telecast, you hear me quote those wonderful words of Jesus, Matthew 4, verse 4. It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Did you get it? Every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. All the words. Or will just some of them do? Can't we pick and choose? Taking the ones that fit in with our plans, the ones we like, the ones that are convenient, leaving the rest? Oh, no, friend. We live by following all of the words that come from the mouth of God. It was the Apostle Paul who said over here in 2 Timothy, the 3rd chapter and the 16th verse, listen to this, 2 Timothy, listen to these words. They're just as true today as when they were penned. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God. So when you go out to find a church with which you can personally become involved, and I hope you'll lose no time in doing just that, look for one that goes by all of the words that come from the mind and the heart of God. Not a church that tells you some of them are inspired and some are not, that some apply and some do not, that some are outdated and some are not. Not a church that preaches only that which is popular and keeps silent about what is not. Not a church that tells you that it's legalistic to do what your Lord commands. Please notice what Jesus said over here in Luke, the 6th chapter and the 46th verse. Matthew, Mark, Luke. Luke 6. Luke 6, 46. Look at this. Jesus said, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and do not what I say? And Jesus hasn't changed his mind. He's still asking that question. The book of Revelation gives us a number of glimpses of God's true people in these last days. And anyone who's looking for a church that meets God's approval ought to be aware of these particular scriptures. Write them down, will you? Here's one of them, right in the heart of that last compelling, fascinating book of Revelation. Revelation 14, verse 12. Revelation 14, 12. Listen, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Now, here are a people whose faith is centered in the Lord Jesus Christ, but they are also a people who love their Lord enough to keep His commandments. In fact, their loyalty to God's commandments is a characteristic that particularly stirs the anger of Satan against them. Now, here's what the book says. Over here, right here in the 12th chapter, in the 17th verse. Look, 17th verse. Then the dragon, Satan, was enraged at the woman, the church, and went off to make war against the rest of her offspring, those who keep God's commandments and hold to the testimony of Jesus. The dragon, or Satan, is enraged with the woman, the church, and makes war with the rest of her offspring, the church in the last days. Why? Because they persist in keeping God's commandments and holding to the testimony of Jesus. Revealing, isn't it? But there is more. Not only are God's people in the last days described here in the book of Revelation, but in the 14th chapter, the message that they will be giving is detailed. Listen, friend, nothing could be more important. For here is God's last call, His last appeal to men. Right here, page over, 14th chapter, verses 6 and 7. Look, and I saw another angel fly in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, Fear God, give glory to Him, for the hour of His judgment is come, and worship Him that made heaven and earth, the sea and the fountains of waters. God's last call, and every word of it vital, an angel with a message so urgent that it's represented as being carried through the air with great speed, a message that must go to all of the world. It's called the everlasting gospel, you see, not something new or strange, the everlasting gospel. And here today, when God is largely forgotten, when man is glorying in his own achievement, when self-worship is so prevalent, when every student is taught that we're the product of long ages of accident and chance, I say here today, we're called upon to worship God and to worship Him as our Creator. Imagine, one who made man in His own image. How appropriate and how desperately needed. Why is this message said to be so urgent? Because we're living in the hour of God's judgment. In the time when the cases of all men are being decided in heaven's court, just before Jesus returns. But there's more. There's a second angel, a second message, here in verse 8. And there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Babylon, the symbol of false worship, the fallen church. Once she was loyal to her Lord, but now she's been unfaithful to Him. Her once pure teachings have been contaminated until they're riddled with error. And she's caused multitudes to become intoxicated with her false teachings. No wonder God pleads with those who are innocently involved in her apostasy. Just a page or two over the 18th chapter, verse 4. Look at this. 18, verse 4, listen, come out of her, my people, that ye be not partakers of her sins, and that ye receive not of her plagues. Well, back to the 14th chapter. There's a third angel here in the 14th chapter, verses 9 and 10. Listen, and the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, If any man worship the beast in his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture. God does not force the will of man. He gives us the facts. He warns, he pleads, but he will not invade the sacred precincts of the will. Every man is free to decide his own destiny, but Satan has no scruples against the use of force. And at the very last, when he sees that he cannot turn God's people from their loyalty to their Lord, he attempts to force the conscience. And God faithfully and urgently and lovingly warns against the fearful results of yielding to pressure and joining Satan's rebellion. In the last few minutes, you've been listening to the most fearful warnings and the most urgent appeals of all Scripture. And so I ask you, would it be any surprise if Satan should turn all his guns against these three messages, try to tamper with them, water them down in the minds of men until their vital significance and their fearful urgency is lost? I say, is it any wonder that God in the very last chapter warns against tampering with the book of Revelation, last few words? But Satan will tamper, and so will men. Efforts will be made to deprive God's final call of its unique urgency. For instance, someone has suggested that John didn't see three angels flying in the midst of heaven, as he says he did, but that he had really seen three modern satellites orbiting the earth. And the implication is that anyone whose message is carried by satellite, no matter what the content of that message might be, is faithfully delivering God's call to men. No, friend, John undoubtedly wouldn't recognize a satellite. But he certainly knew what an angel looked like, and he wouldn't confuse the two. But here's the important thing. Remember this. It is the content of a man's message that gives it authenticity, not the means by which it's delivered. You see, these three messages of Revelation 14 are so important, so urgent, that they're represented as going with great speed and going to all of the world. God uses an angel to represent the speed with which messages would be given. Now, this doesn't mean that angels will fly through the sky with loud speakers and shout their messages down to us. God uses men and women, not angels, to relay his messages, at least most of the time. It's only occasionally that angels step in directly to communicate with us. Now, I'm sure that as God looked into the future, he saw his message being carried by radio, by television, by satellite, by the printed page, and by word of mouth. God has provided every means for his message to go quickly to all of the world. But remember, it's the content of the message that gives it authenticity, whether carried by satellite or by horseback. Oh, friend, that message of Revelation 14 is the everlasting gospel. Not something new or strange. There never has been and never will be any gospel but the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the Son of God taking our guilt upon himself, paying the penalty for our sins, dying in our place so that we could live. But that everlasting gospel in our day in Revelation 14, in God's last call to men, takes on judgment our urgency. It takes on the urgency of a soon coming king. It takes on the urgency of life and death issues peculiar to our day. And how we relate to those issues will demonstrate once and for all, with eternal consequences, our loyalty or lack of loyalty to the one who gave his life for us. Friend, you have an enemy who would like to water down the message in your mind, rob it of its power by leaving out or at least soft-pedaling the urgencies that God himself has put into it. But don't let it happen. Nothing less than an unconditional commitment to your Lord will be sufficient for the critical days ahead. And there's so little time. Shall we pray? Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for television. We thank you for genuine concern that it not be misused or misjudged by misuse. Bless all who hear and lead all those who hear into actual fellowship beyond the confines of the home. How desperately we need to worship side by side with a Bible in the hand as we search God's day, last day message, searching with people who are studying just like ourselves. We need each other in order to grow. It's too late not to do so. And so in this wonderful day of electronic evangelism, help us to use it wisely. Wisely enough to let our convictions follow us home to church fellowship. And so while we thank God for television, we thank God for the church as well. For we need both. Above all, we need you and your saving power. For it's in your name that we ask all these blessings. Amen.
My name is Lonnie Melashenko. Have you felt the urgency in Pastor Vandeman's message today? I'm sure you have, but it may have left some questions in your mind. You sense that critical days are ahead, but what will the issues be in the final conflict? What is this mark of the beast that Pastor Vandeman was reading about from the book of Revelation? You owe it to yourself to find out. Otherwise, how can you avoid it? Our gift for you today is a book that will answer your many questions. It's Pastor Vandeman's book, A Day to Remember. And every viewer desperately needs the information it contains. We'll tell you in a moment how to ask for your free copy. A Day to Remember is a book that we offer only occasionally. It contains information we've never given on the telecast. Whatever you do, don't fail to ask for this book. Ask for it by name, A Day to Remember, so we'll know which book to send. And now here is the information you need.
You may request Pastor Vandeman's free offer by writing directly to It Is Written, Box O, Thousand Oaks, California, 91360. The offer is sent by mail free and postpaid. Our address is easy to remember. Just It Is Written, Box O, that's Box 0, Thousand Oaks, California, 91360. Please be sure to ask for the offer by name. It takes only a few moments to write, but it could mean a lifetime of satisfaction. While you're writing down the address, let me remind you to invite a friend to watch It Is Written with you next week on this station. The address again is It Is Written, Box O, Thousand Oaks, California, 91360.
Thank you, Lonnie. And now the time has come all too quickly to say goodbye, everyone. But remember, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God.